Hello everyone, welcome to part 2 of our Unreal Engine 4 combination lock tutorial in Blueprints. So, just to get right to it, we're going to open up the project where we last left off and open up our BP lock tumbler. My version might look slightly different than yours. I went ahead just to make sure everything was working for the tutorial, and then I came back and made some changes. But essentially, this is what you should have from the last tutorial. So, the first thing we're going to do is we're actually going to take this entire section here, and we're going to copy it. And we're going to paste it down below, because now we want to add in the ability to actually spin the tumbler backwards. So let's see, going for naming consistency, that's spin tumbler. This one will be called spin tumbler backward. And here we're going to call this spin tumbler backward reset. Oops, don't need a 4 in there. Haha, it's Resident Evil 4. anyways. Okay, so a couple of changes we need to make. So firstly, we're no longer going to be adding tumbler rotation there. We're going to be subtracting it, actually, just to make it easier. So we have a guide. So we're going to drag out from the tumbler rotation. We're going to type in minus. And that'll give us float minus float. And then we'll just control drag these pins, so it's faster to reconnect everything. So now we're going to be subtracting rotation. So what we have to do at the end here is we actually have to take this greater than or equal to 360. And with the we have to change it to a less than or equal to and negative 360. And that's because we're going to be spinning it completely backwards. And once we get to negative 360 degrees, we actually want to set it back to positive 0 to allow us to loop. Okay, so now inside of our number check, we have to zoom way out, and we're just going to do a marquee selection around the entire thing. You don't have to worry because it's not going to duplicate that entry node there. So we're going to copy, and we're going to paste in here, and connect this up. And now what we're going to do is, oh, actually, I made one little mistake there. Let's just back that up, paste it in again. We don't need the first one because we don't need another 0 in here. So I can get rid of all that. And plug that in. We're going to change all of these to negative values. So we're going to go with negative 36 and, oops, negative 72, 108, 144, 180, 216, 252, 288, 324, and 360. Compile and save. Then we're going to go back to our event graph here. We're going to drag a marquee around those and press C to make a comment. We're going to name this spin tumbler. And then let's see, these are our controls here for spinning the tumbler forward. This is our begin play. So I'm going to move the begin play up here. Put a comment around that. And these controls are going to be deleted in a bit. But for now, going to right click, let's deselect that first, and press 0 on the keyboard to get the 0 key, and we're going to drag out spin tumbler backward, and then again show tumbler number, compile and save. So let's make another room here. Perfect. And we're going to drag our tumbler out and rotate it 90 degrees. And let's just scale it up a bit too, so we can have a giant Price is Right wheel. Alright, so now you'll see that if we press 9, we're going to rotate forward. And if all is working well, now when we press 0, it will rotate backwards. Oh, but apparently it's only going to do that once because we're not resetting. So after we copied and pasted this, we didn't actually reset our spin tumbler because we used the old one. So we want spin tumbler backward reset in there. Plug that in, compile and save, and we should be good to go. So pressing 9, we're rotating forward. 2, 3, 4. Good. 3, 4. Ah, it's up higher. That's why we need that marker on the lock. 3, 2, 1, 0. Now we should get... Ah! I made one more mistake. The last thing we needed to do with this number check is we have to invert all of these here. So after we get down to 9 and we go back to 0, we now actually have to count backwards. So 9, 8, 7, 6, 5 stays the same, 4, 3, 2, 1, and another 0, compile and save. Alright, let's see. 9 goes forward. Actually, you know what? In the event graph here, we've already got a show tumbler number happening there, so we can drop these two. We don't need them showing up twice. Alright, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now we go backwards, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Back around to 0, and we're still going backwards and forwards. So yay, we've got that functioning fine. All right, so our tumbler is finally finished. So we're going to delete these little cheat keys there. And we'll leave the show tumbler number for now because it's handy for our debugging. And the next thing we want to do is we want to go to our meshes here. And we're going to open up the lock combination. We're going to assign our lock material. And once we've done that, we can jump over to the skeleton. Now on the skeleton here, we're going to select the bone lock. We're going to right click and we're going to add a socket. And we're going to call this tumbler socket. Now, after we do that, we actually have to adjust the relative location. So we're going to add 5 there. And in the relative rotation in the X, we need to set it to minus 90, if I remember correctly. We'll leave that open for now. Save those two. And let's see, from here, we can go back into our blueprints. We're going to right click. Choose a new blueprint class and actor. I'm going to call this BP underscore lock and then combination. And this is actually going to be our full lock. So same as always, oops, S-C-E-N-E. We're going to create a scene component, rename it root, and then drag it up on top of the root to get rid of that little sphere that I hate. We're going to add a skeletal mesh, and we're going to call this lock mesh. And then we're going to assign the static mesh of lock combination on our root. Actually, I was going to rescale it here, but because it's large, it's easier for navigating right now. We'll rescale it at the end, provided I remember. So after we choose our lock combination, we're going to have to minimize. One other thing we want to do is we want to actually create, right click on the lock combination mesh, and we're going to go create anim blueprint. And we're going to name this, let's see, lock combination. Just get rid of that underscore skeleton. Anim blueprint. So we're going to open this up. And then we're going to import our animations. So here we have lock combination closed, open, and unlock. And again, those files are going to be included in the description down below, so make sure you grab those. You probably already grabbed them in the last tutorial, however. So here we're going to uncheck import mesh. And we should see that our lock combination skeleton has been chosen by default. If it isn't, you can always change it in the drop-down list. But right now we're good. And then you're just going to choose import all, so you don't have to click the button three times for each of those animations. Right-click and save. And we should see now, if we double-click the lock combination, and we go to the animation tab, you should see that we have all of these animations. So we've got our closed animation, we've got our open animation, and we've got the transition, which is unlock. Probably didn't name those the best, but it's fine for now. So back in our blueprint, we're going to go to the event graph. And we're going to delete this try get pawn owner, because that does not work for anything other than a character. And we're going to right click and go get owning actor. And then we're going to cast to lock, BP lock combination, plug that in here. And as BP lock combination, actually we have to create that. So we're going to go back to BP lock combination. We're going to create a new variable, and we're going to call this locked state. Compile, save. Now back here, we'll have access to that locked state. So we're going to get our locked state, and we're going to promote it to a variable within our anim BP. And we're going to call this variable locked question mark. And plug that in there. So essentially what we're doing is on update animation, which is essentially the same as a tick, we're getting the owner actor, which is actually saying to grab the mesh within the BP here. And we're checking to make sure that it is a lock combination. And if it is, we're pulling the locked state and then setting it to our locked value. So when the locked state is true, then it's actually going to say locked is true. And when the locked state is false, it's going to read as opposite, which is unlocked. Hooray. So back over in our anim graph here, we're going to right click and we're going to choose state. Choose. I always say choose instead of type. We're going to type state machine. And we're going to call this state machine just default state, and we're going to plug that in here. And we're going to double click on our default state, and we're going to right click and choose add state, and we're going to call this locked. Plug this in here, and then we're going to go from locked, drag out from the edge rather than the center. So we're going to drag out from the edge, and we're going to add another state here, and we're going to call this unlock, or not unlocked, unlock. And then we're going to drag out here and add a state, and we're going to call this open. And then we're going to drag again and plug it in to our locked. Not that we'll ever actually transition from open to locked, but it's good to have a complete circuit here. So now, inside all of these transitions, actually, before we get into the transitions, let's drop in our animations. In fact, let's start with our locked here. And we're going to drag out our closed animation and plug that in there. Go back to our default state, jump into the unlocked, or unlock rather. Drag in our animation for unlock. And then go back and open. Drag in our open animation. Good. Now we can do the states. So to transition from locked to unlock, really simple. We just get locked and we check to see if it's not true. So we use an exclamation mark to get not Boolean. And if locked is not true, then we're going to play the unlock animation. And then over here from unlock, we're going to get time remaining ratio. Lock combination unlock, and then we're going to say is less than, so float is less than 0.2, then we can enter that transition, and from open to back, same thing, we're just going to drag our locked in there though, because we don't need the not, and if locked is true, then it's going to transition back to being locked. Compile and save this, and you'll see that automatically it unlocks. Why did that happen? Well, because our locked state by default in our blueprint is actually set to untrue, which means that in our anim graph it saw that the locked state was false, which means it's open, and it transitioned all the way around, and now it's actively on open. So we could preview this by going to the anim preview editor, and we could just toggle this state here. And you'll see when we toggle it on and off, we get a nice locking and unlocking loop. So we're going to reset that back to its default and save that. Perfect. So now the next step is we need to add in our tumblers. So you'd think that we'd be able to click on add component and type in tumbler, but clearly that's not bringing anything up. So I found the easiest thing to do is actually go back to our blueprints and we just drag the tumbler in. So we might want to adjust our window a little bit here. I'm going to drag the tumbler in and on top of our lock mesh. So, even though we dragged it on top of the lock mesh, it didn't seem to parent it there, so we're going to drag it back on top. Now you see this little arrow and you know it's parented. We're going to call this lock tumbler 1, and then you will see that it's actually gone in the exact right place. So the next one we're going to do is, actually let's pick the parent socket here first. So we're going to go tumbler socket. And then we're going to duplicate that. So we get a tumbler 2, tumbler 3, and tumbler 4. Now, tumbler 2 is going to be 5 degrees further out, tumbler 3 is going to be 10, and tumbler 4 is going to be 15, because they're all 5 units wide. And now you'll see that we have all 4 of our tumblers in place. And if we compile and save, then on our lock mesh, for our animation mode, we want to use anim blueprint. And for our blueprint, we're going to choose our lock combination. Now, you'll see that only the first one actually rotated. So that's because we have to reparent these. I was hoping that it would remember the parented socket, but that's okay. So we're just going to choose tumbler socket, and you'll see that it redoes our little animation there. Whoops. Parent socket, tumbler socket, parent socket, tumbler socket. And now we've got all of our tumblers actually moving with the lock itself, which is exactly what we want. Compile and save. And now we can take our lock state here and turn it back to true, which is what we want for the default value. And now over in our event graph, delete all those. I like to add them in when I want to. Epic can't tell me when I'm going to add those in. Chuh. Anyways. So I'm going to minimize that 3D viewport for a second and look at my cheat sheet here. So what are we going to do next? The next thing we're going to do is we're going to create a variable, and we're going to call this combination. And we're going to set this to a string, and we're going to compile and save. And then we're going to set our default value of our combination to, let's see, 0123. Compile and save again. I probably do that way too often. We're also going to create a variable. I probably should have done that when it was already set to Boolean, but that's okay. We can switch them around, and we're going to call this, why is that not working here? Random, let's go randomize rotation. Let's see. Yeah, randomize tumbler rotation. Question mark. We're going to make it instance editable, so that'll actually bring this little eyeball on. And we're going to say if yes, random sizes the initial rotation of the tumblers. Okay, perfect. And now we're also going to start building out our checking here. So we're going to have to use a tick. Now, I don't really like to use ticks because they're just more system intensive. However, in this case, it's a pretty non-system intensive setup. And to negate some of the tick here, we're going to drag out and we're going to add in a delay. So we're not actually going to be doing anything every frame. We're going to be putting a delay of 1 second here. So every second we're going to check for this state. Then we're going to create a function. And this function is going to be called check combination. And in here, what we're going to do is we're going to get all of our tumblers here. And we're going to drag them out into the scene. And we're going to, let's reorder these. 1, 2, 3, 4. This is very important for these to be in the correct order. So now, this is something that actually stumped me for a good few hours, actually, because I couldn't figure out why, once we have brought our BP tumblers in, you can't just start getting values from our tumbler in here. So tumbler number, for example, if we type in tumbler, we actually get nothing. We've just got an option to set these, even though inside of our tumbler blueprint, we've actually got our tumbler number value. So it took me forever to figure out why I couldn't just access these because they're blueprints. Well, what happens is when you throw a blueprint in here, you'll see that it's actually calling it a child actor component. So what we have to do is we have to actually get child actor. Okay, and we're going to duplicate that and then duplicate those two. So we have four of them. We're going to plug these in here. And then we have to cast back to our test to tumbler, bplock tumbler. But because we know this is going to work, there's literally no way that this cast could fail because these are actually bplock tumblers. So we're just going to right click and convert this to a pure cast. And that just saves us having to plug them all into this check combination right there. So we're going to duplicate that. And then again, select the two of them and duplicate those again with Control W. And we're going to plug them in to their corresponding Tumblr reference. All right. So now that we've got our list of our tumblers and we've basically converted them back to being themselves, we can drag out here and say get tumbler number and same thing, duplicate and then duplicate and plug all of these in. So what we're doing here is we're getting whatever the tumbler number is for each of these tumblers because they're all going to be independent. And then we are going to say get our combination, and we're going to say if our combination is equal to, so you type two equals to get an equal to, so we're going to say if our combination is equal to, and then we're going to drag out here and we're going to do an append, and we're essentially going to add two more pins. And then maybe shove this all a little bit forward. Then we're going to drag out of our tumblers. And this is why the order is super important, guys, because if we have these in the incorrect order, then our combination is going to be in the incorrect order and it will never line up correctly. So we're going to get tumbler number one there, two, three, and four. I don't know why that one decided to stack on top of the others. And so essentially what we're doing is we're adding these numbers together to form a longer string. So each of these is going to return a single digit, but when we append them all together, the output is going to be four digits all mashed together. And we're going to check that against our combination, which is also four digits. And actually, we're going to make this instance editable. And our tooltip here is going to be must be four numbers, or I could say digits, I suppose, in length. Oops, can't spell. No more, no less. All right. And then we're going to get a return node. And on the return, we're going to create an output. And we're going to call this combo match question mark. And if this is true, then our combo match is going to also read true. Compile, save. Back in the event graph. So now what we're going to do is we're going to drag out our new check combination function and plug that in here. And we're going to plug in our combo match into a branch. And only when this is true, we're actually going to unlock our lock. So we're going to drag out from the true here. And if you type in once, you get a do once node. I sometimes start by trying to type in do, but that actually brings up too many other options. So from here, we're going to get our locked state, alt, drag it in to set it. And we're going to set our locked state to false because our default value is true. And now we're setting it to be unlocked. Then we're going to add in another delay here. And this delay is actually going to give us enough time for that animation to play out. So we're going to do about 1.5 seconds. The way I came up with that number is if we go back to our lock combination and we take a look at the animations. So we have our unlock animation, so where we're transitioning from locked to unlocked. And you'll see here that it says it's 1 second long. And I wanted to give it a little bit of time for us to register that it's actually open. So we're going to play that for half a second, and then we're going to do some extra stuff here. So going back to our BP lock combination, after our delay there, the extra stuff I was talking about is we're going to drag out our lock mesh and we're going to simulate physics on this. So first thing we need to do is we actually have to make sure that we have collision on our lock mesh. So you'll remember that when we created this, when we initially imported it, we actually created a physics body. So we've got our physics asset. So we know we have collision here. We can set simulate physics and you'll see that it falls over nicely. So that's all fine and dandy. However, by default, if we scroll down on our lock mesh, our collision is set to no collision. So we want to set this to block all. Then we're actually going to bring it up again and we're going to go custom. Because we don't actually want it to block all. We want it to ignore all. Now, you might think I'm crazy. Why did I choose block all and then go custom and ignore all? Because that's negating itself. Well, the reason being is because if we were to choose no collision and then change this here, we want it to block world static. So if we chose no collision by default from our collision presets, it would actually change this collision enabled to no collision as well, which is not what we want. So it's easier to first go block all and then custom and ignore everything except world static. That just ensures that it's actually going to work. I'm going to compile and save again. And from here, we're going to go set. Actually, we're not going to go set. We're going to go simulate physics. And we're going to set all bodies simulate physics on the lock mesh. I don't know why it adds in another lock mesh, but that's fine. We can delete it easily. And our new simulate is going to be true. So then we're going to add in a brief delay here of probably 0.4 seconds. And then we're going to, then what we're actually going to do is we need our unlockable actor. So with our combination lock here, we have to be able to trigger something to actually open. So how would you go about doing that? Well, the easiest way is to actually create a new blueprint class of actor again, and we're going to call this BP underscore unlockable. And I'm just going to set up a very basic unlockable here, But you guys should be able to figure out how you can actually modify this to make it more versatile in the future. But essentially, we're going to go into our BP underscore unlockable, and we're going to add in a new scene component, as always. Rename this root, drag over the original root. So now we're going to do a static mesh, and let's see, we're going to call this unlockable mesh. And then we're going to add new feature or content pack because I didn't do this at first. When we go to content packs, we're going to choose our starter content. Okay. Give it a second to add that in. And now you'll see we actually have some architecture like doorways and doors themselves. Let's see, where are the doors? There's a door in here somewhere. There we go. SM door frame, SM door. So we're going to open up our SM door and we're going to look at our simple collision. You'll see that we don't have any. So we need collision on this. I don't know why they gave us a door mesh without actual collision on it because that's entirely useless. But Epic is fallible. It's okay. We can fix that pretty easily. So we're just going to, again, I did collision, add box simplified. We're going to save that. And then that's actually going to stop us from walking through that door. And over here, we're going to specify our static mesh. And we're going to type in door, and we'll choose our SM door. And now we actually have a door that we can lock or unlock with this combination. Now, clearly, this style of door is not usually the one that has a combo lock on it. You would imagine it would be something like a locker. I didn't want to bother going through the process of creating a locker mesh with you guys because it's kind of moot for this tutorial. So you could use this on all sorts of things. It could be a briefcase or anything else. I leave it up to you guys to come up with your meshes here. So we're going to delete all these. Again, I don't like to be told when I'm going to use those or why. I know Epic's trying to help out because those are the most commonly used nodes, but let's assume intelligence as opposed to stupidity, guys. Okay, so let's see, what are we doing here with our unlockable? So what we're going to want to do is actually just set up a simple rotation for our unlockable mesh here. So if we go to our viewport and we click on our unlockable mesh, you'll see that our pivot point is right on that hinge there. So that's great. And we want to be able to open our door. So we're probably going to open it to about 120 degrees. Awesome. I'm just going to reset that. We're going to go back to our event graph. We're going to create a custom event. Add custom event, and we're going to call this unlock. And from the unlock, we are going to set rot. We're going to set our relative rotation, not our world rotation. That's very important because relative to the position of this blueprint. And we're going to do that with a timeline. Same way you want to basically animate anything that is static in the world. And on update, we're going to split the struct pin here because we don't want to rotate it on multiple axes, just the Z. And in our timeline, we double click. We're going to add a float track. We're going to call this alpha. And we're going to give it a length of 1 second. We're going to choose use last keyframe. And we're going to shift click twice in the timeline. First one, we want our time 0, and the default value of 0 is great. Second one, time 1, value 1. And click on these to maximize or zoom to the selected sizes. And we're going to right click and choose auto for just a nice smooth curve, which I feel works better with, well, I mean, I guess a door could actually look fine with the linear animation, but it just eases it in. So a linear curve, just a straight line, means that when it plays the animation, it's going to use the exact same speed across the entire thing, which can look fine with a door. However, if you're really opening and closing a door, it's going to slow down a little bit at the end, and maybe it's also going to be a little slow at the beginning. So that's what that curve does. It just means it starts out slow, speeds up, and then slows down at the end there. So you could play with this. You could drag this handle up. You could have it start fast if you wanted to, and then slow down at the end if we really wanted to get nitpicky. Okay, and from unlock, we're just going to choose play. And we're going to take our rotation. And we're going to do, what do we want to do? We want to rotate it by. So we're going to take our alpha, and we're going to multiply that float by float. And we're going to rotate it 120 degrees. And we're going to right click and then promote that to a variable and call this rotation amount. And you can expose that if you want to. How much the door, or rather not how much, but how far the door will rotate and or move, depending on how you set this up. We're going to plug that into Z there. Compile and save. So now we've got a door that can actually open. So back in our, nope, not in our tumbler, we want our lock combination. What we want to do now is we want to create a reference to our BP unlockable. So we're going to add that in as a variable here. We're going to call this BP unlockable. And we're going to switch our variable type to BP unlockable. And you can choose to click directly on the object type here, and it'll just automatically grab an object reference because that's what we want. But just so you know, there are other options there. We're going to use the object reference as default. So just click directly on BP unlockable. Then what we're going to do is we're going to make that instance editable. Editable. I like to slur my words, apparently. And the specific unlockable to unlock. And so this is a really cool functionality of Unreal Engine 4. So when we create a variable of our unlockable, and then we actually make it instance editable, what that does is it allows us to specify the unlockable object inside the map. So if we go into our 3D view here, and we can delete our giant tumbler from earlier, and we can go to our blueprints, and we can drag in a lock, and we'll leave it really large for now, just because it's easier to see. So we've got our lock there. And then we've got our unlockable. We'll imagine that we've got an actual doorway there that we're gaining access to. You'll see that when we select our lock and we look at the details, sorry guys, if you can hear that, there's a siren of some sort going off in the background. Hold on. Wait for that emergency to pass, and good luck to whoever's in need. Okay, so where were we? You'll see that with our BP unlockable, you get the little eyedropper here, and when you click on that, we can go over to our 3D viewport, and we can select the specific unlockable that we want this combination lock to trigger. And then you'll see here that now it's specified BP underscore unlockable. Oh, the emergency is actually happening close by. Hold on. I'm staying at a friend's house right now, and he happens to live right across the street from a fire hall. So you hear sirens here all the time. It's peachy keen, especially at 10 at night. Anyways, so we've been able to specify our unlockable, and you'll notice that if we actually were to give this unlockable another name, so it's easier to actually reference in our level, so we could call this like door to bedroom. Just imagining that that's what this would be in the world. And then we click back on our lock, you'll see that BP unlockable is now set to BP unlockable door to bedroom. So it's really cool. So it creates that link between the two, and it makes it really easy for us to access the code that we set up in that unlockable object, which is our unlock custom event. So we're going to leave the combination at 0123. We're not quite ready for that. So we're going to go back to our lock combination, and we're going to continue along this line here. Let me minimize that. So where were we? We just finished setting all bodies to simulate. We're going to give it 0.4 seconds just to kind of register, and then we're going to drag in a copy of our BP unlockable, and from here we're going to drag out. And the nice thing is, because we're creating this as a variable and we're not embedding it into the lock itself, this you don't actually have to do that child actor nonsense. You can actually just drag directly out, which is why it took me so long to figure out that child actor thing when you were embedding the blueprints inside the other blueprint. Anyways, so directly from here we can call our unlock event, and I'm going to plug that in there, and then we're going to delay again, and this delay is just to allow the lock itself to fall to the ground, because essentially what we're going to do is we're going to set it to simulate physics. The reason I'm doing that is just because it's a little bit easier to just tell it to simulate physics than it is to create a whole animation of it coming off of the lock. I'm imagining that on a locker you typically have two metal flaps that stick out with a hole in them that you slide the lock itself through. And rather than creating a custom animation where that lock actually, rotates and pulls out, I figured it would just be easier and gets the point across to have it simulate physics and fall to the ground. So this delay here is just going to be before we actually turn our physics simulation off. So this gives it 2 seconds to fall to the ground, and then after 2 seconds, we're going to set all bodies, simulate physics again. We're going to turn that off. And that way you can't just go punting your lock around the level. Oops, not BP unlockable. We want our lock mesh. And we're going to double click there to clean up our lines here a bit. Bring that one up. And then we should be good to go, actually, according to my cheat sheet there. So we're going to drag a selection around all that and give it a comment, and we're going to call this check for correct combination. Did I spell it right? I did. Yay! All right. So that is the meat and potatoes of our lock here. So as I was saying earlier, typically you don't want to run anything off of event tick. It would be better if from our Tumblr we got a reference to the lock itself, the BP lock combination, and then every time we show the Tumblr number or do the number check, this is when we could actually call our check to see if the combination is true event. But it's a little bit more difficult, so I thought just for simplicity's sake, we'll go back to our lock combination. We'll do this on an event tick, but we're putting a delay in there and a branch. So really it's only checking every second, and then only when it's true are we actually going to do anything. So this is actually a really not very system intensive setup, so we're fine there. And then also the do once means it's only going to happen once, and then afterwards, even if this is true, it's never going to fire again for this specific lock. So it's pretty efficient. So what else do we need to do? So we need to set up our randomized tumbler. So over here, we've got our randomized tumbler rotation. And I believe we might have had that previously set up in your version. However, I went ahead and deleted it while I was coming up with the way to actually make the lock spin or the tumbler spin backwards. So if you guys have got that right now somewhere in your event graph here, just go ahead and delete it, because you're not going to be setting the whether or not we're randomizing the rotation. We're not actually going to be setting that inside the tumbler anymore. So we're going to delete that randomize rotation variable because it's not needed. However, we do want our randomize tumbler function, because we're definitely going to be using that. So we're going to compile and save there. We're going to go back into our lock combination, and we're going to right click and type begin play, and on event begin play, we are going to, well, let's go back to our check combination so we don't have to do this whole thing again. We're going to drag out and copy that. We're going to go back to our event graph and paste this in. So now we're getting our tumblers again, but we don't need our tumbler number this time. We want to drag out and do randomize tumbler, which is our function. And we're going to copy that and then duplicate those two as well with Control W and plug these in as necessary. We can plug these into each other so they're all firing off one after the other. And over here, we're going to say randomize tumbler rotation. So control drag that in, hold the B key for a branch, plug that in there. And if randomize tumbler rotation is true, then we are going to randomize the tumblers. And if it's false, we're going to do nothing because we don't need to do anything. Compile and save. And then we can drag out, put a comment around that, and call this randomize tumblers question mark. Okay, so you can drag that over here to clean it up a little bit. Actually, because I'm OCD, I like to line these up on that center line there and give them enough space so that when you're zoomed out, these bubbles don't overlap each other. That might be a little bit too much space. Drag that up a bit more. There we go. Oh, and we missed our last one here because the comment box wasn't long enough. Okay, so the last thing we need is we need a way to actually control spinning those tumblers. So if we go back into our content browser and we look at our first person BP, we go to our blueprints, we've got our first person character here. So I'm going to show you guys how not only we can check for our tumbler there, but we can do it out of a context sensitive action. So right now we've got input action fire, so that's one of our inputs. And if we edit project settings and we go to our input here, we're going to create another that is what we wanted to do. Sorry, I thought I hit one of these pluses. We're going to create a new action mapping, and we're going to call this alternate fire. And We're gonna go right mouse. Oops, mouse. Mousey, mousey. I can spell well. Right mouse button. And then we're gonna add in another one here. And I'm guessing this one is right trigger. Yep. So we're gonna change this one to left trigger for our alternate there. I'm gonna close that down. Saves automatically, so don't worry there. Okay, so now, instead of doing this off of input action fire, what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a custom event, and we're going to call this fire gun, and control drag that out and plug it in there. So we're going to steal our input action here. So ignoring the fact that we've got a touch control going directly into this, I'm going to assume that we're not building this out for a mobile game anyways, and just ignore it entirely. So input action fire. So we want to be able to check, have a way to check when we're actually using lock. So how would you go about doing that? Well, in our lock combination here, the easiest way to check if we're actually using a lock is to create a trigger box around the lock itself. So we're going to add a component, and we're going to drag down until we get a box collision, and we're going to call this lock trigger, and we're going to change its default scale. Actually, we don't need to change that right now because we're going to set it inside of our construction script here. So we're going to drag in our lock trigger, and we're going to do two things. We're going to set scale, and we're going to choose set relative scale 3D, which is what we want. And this new scale, instead of 000, we're actually going to go with something like 1, let's just make it up, 5 and 100. And then we're going to right click and promote to variable. I don't know why I said oops. I thought it was going to do some sort of variable with the entire thing. Anyways, and we're going to call this lock trigger scale. And we're going to make that instance editable. And I don't really think we need a tooltip because it's self-explanatory, but if you want to, you can fill that in because the engine likes to have it, apparently, because it's given us a warning that there's no tooltip there. And then we're also going to drag out, and we're going to go set lock, and we want set relative location. Again, this is very important. You want relative location, not world location, because if we set the relative location, it's actually going to be in relation to the root component, whereas if we set world location, that's going to be in your whole level. So 000 relative location is actually in the dead center where it is right now. 000 of the world, though, could be anywhere in your world, which is not where you want it to be. So just be wary of that. And same thing right now, because we know that this scale is going to be 1, 5, and 100, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to the trigger itself here and go 1, 5, 100. And then we'll see in the viewport what that looks like. So we got a really tall and really thin trigger. Maybe 100 is a bit much. Maybe I'll go 1, 5, and 50. So same thing here, trigger scale, oops, compile. And we're going to change that to 50. And back in our construction script here, so our location, we're actually going to want to put it 50 up in the z-axis so that it's lined up with the ground. And we can leave the x and y in the center, that's fine. So right click again, promote to variable, and call this lock trigger location. Again, turn that on, pull that down, and compile and save. So now we have the ability to change the scale and the location of the trigger once we drag an instance of it into the world. So let's see, here we have our combination, then we have a randomized tumbler rotation, then we have the unlockable to specify, and then we have this. So if we wanted to actually put these into a category, what we could do is go up to our combination here in the details panel category. We can call this lock settings maybe, and then over here we can actually drag these up. So first thing we want to do is we want to actually specify the unlockable, then we can specify the combination, and then we can do our randomize rotation and our scale and the location. And I'm just dragging these all up on top of combination. That always puts them above in the list, so then we can drag our combination and drag it on top of the randomized tumbler rotation. And there we go. Now we've got the correct order that we want. So these are the order that they're going to show up in when we drag an instance in the world and we look at the details panel. So that's fine. We can minimize that or leave it open, actually. Easier to grab references to later. Now, what we're going to do here is back in our first person character, we want to create a variable, and we're going to call this using lock question mark. Compile that, save that. Now back in our lock combination, we're going to grab our lock trigger. We're not going to grab it, we're going to highlight it and right click, and we're going to add an event, and we're going to call this add on component begin overlap. And then we're going to do the same thing, right click, add event on component end overlap. So compile, save. We're going to drag out from other actor, and we're going to cast to first person character. And from here, we're going to set, what did I call it? Using lock. And we're going to set using lock there, and we're going to duplicate those, and also other actor set using lock there. The only difference is we want the top one checked. So essentially, when our player, the first person character, now this is where you have to be careful. If you're going to have multiple characters that the player can possess in the game, then you don't want to cast specifically to one of them. You want to just other actor get player character. However, because this is the only character we're using, then we're actually going to do casting directly to it. I would actually even suggest you, if you have multiple characters, you would want to set up a master character. And that's where you would want to cast to. And then you wouldn't have to implement this for every one of your characters. You could just make all of your future characters a child of your master character. All right, so essentially, when we overlap that trigger, we're going to set the using lock to true. And when we end the overlap, we're going to set the using lock to false. So that should be good. And the reason we made the trigger here so thin is because we don't want, if you're going to have multiple locks beside each other, for example, a row of lockers, you don't want the player to be able to accidentally stand inside of two different triggers at the same time. In fact, if we take the scale and we set this to 0.5, it might be even better. It looked like it was offsetting it a little bit. In fact, I think it is because the lock itself isn't centered to the world. So location probably on our X. We want to set this to maybe 4. Let's go with 5. That's closer to center of the lock itself, which is what you will be aiming at. With the player cursor. All right, so over here, we want to grab our using lock and get it. And we're going to branch. And let's see, input action fire using lock. If using lock is true, then we're going to run our lock code. And if using lock is false, then we're going to try running fire gun. Okay, and so this is implementing our context sensitive controls. So, whoops, hey, let's put that over there. And we're going to go interaction controls. Okay, now down here, we need to say, what are we going to do? We're going to do a trace for lock. Typically, what I would do when building out a game is I would only have one line trace. And then depending on the situation, it's either going to fire the gun or it's going to interact with the thing that the trace hits. However, because... Oops, I'm getting a new notification about deals on Humble Bundle. Yay! I can't afford any of them anyways, even on Humble, so there we go. Anyways, getting back to this, because I haven't really spent any time looking at the first person blueprint setup here, rather than trying to figure out how I could reuse this trace, I'm just going to create a whole new one. So what we're going to do is we want all of this here from the calculate adjusted direction and the player viewpoint. So we don't need the montage and we don't need the firing sound, but we do want the rest of it. So we're going to drag all this out and we're going to copy that, and then we're going to go down here and paste. And I realize we got that extra comment box, so we can delete that. And we're going to go right-click, custom event, and we're going to call this trace for lock. We're going to plug that in there. And this is, again, just to give you guys an idea of how you can handle context-sensitive controls. Clearly, I'm not doing this in the best way possible. Let's just drag that out there. Sure. Also, this is a really complex way of getting the center of the screen. This is not how I would normally handle a line trace. I would usually do it from the first-person camera itself, but whatever. Since Epic decided that this is the way they were going to do it, we will not question them. And so at the end here, we don't need any of this rigmarole because we're not adding an impulse to any of it. And we actually are not going to grab hit component. We're going to go hit actor. And if, hell, I don't even need to check to see if it's valid, that's fine. Maybe we will check to see if it's valid. It's better to do an is valid check because it just saves any errors after the fact. Okay, so over with our lock tumbler. We want hit actor or hit component. Technically, that is a component. You know what? Let's just keep it on hit actor for now. So back in our lock tumbler, we don't really need to be in the event graph, but anyways, we're going to click on our BP lock tumbler self. And then in the details panel, we're going to type in tag. I actually already did this earlier, as you can see. So you guys will have no tag there. So we're just going to hit the plus and we're going to type tumbler. And then once you hit enter, you can also copy that. And we're going to go back into our first person character here. And we're going to say hit actor and then tag And then actor has tag. And in here, that's where we're going to paste in our Tumblr tag. And if this is also true, we are going to spin the Tumblr forward or backward. So let's see here. This is trace for lock. So since we want to be able to run that both from our left click and our right click, what we're going to need to do is say create a variable here, and we're going to say, what are we going to call this? We're going to call this secondary input question mark. And we're going to drag this out. And we're going to say branch again. And if true, there we go. And if using secondary input is true, we're gonna go, whoops, we're gonna get our actor and we're going to cast to Tumblr, and false, and then true, and plug that back into the hit actor. Maybe we can clean these lines up a bit. Whoops. Plug that there. And that there. And this one, let's see, one there. And one there. I don't know why I always need those to be perfectly straight. It really doesn't matter. Okay, and then we're going to go spin Tumblr. And let's see, so if secondary input is true, we're going to spin it backwards. And if secondary input is false, spin Tumblr forward. All right. Compile, save. Now, let's see, we want to input action controls. Okay. So input fire. We are going to say, what are we going to do? Input fire secondary input is going to be set secondary input. I'm going to set that to false. And then put right click and go type in secondary. What did I call it? Alternate? Yeah, alternate fire. And we're going to set our secondary input on pressed to true. And we're going to say if we are using the lock again, so if using lock, and up here we need a true for using lock, so we're going to go trace for lock, and if using lock is true, trace for lock again. And there we go. So we've got our interaction controls. Compile, save. And down here at our trace for lock, we're just going to turn this on to for duration for now, just to double check to see if that's working. And you'll see we've got our lock trigger there. Now, because this lock is so huge, the trigger is actually a lot bigger, but we're going to scale that down in a minute. So actually, let's just do that now. So on our root mesh, we're going to click on the lock here so that they're all changed at the same time, so it's uniform. And we're going to set that to 0.2 because that's how big our lock was in the world. That's much better. Looks about the size of the door. And I would imagine we probably want it to be, let's actually put this on the door handle. Yep. So here's a hotkey for you guys in case you don't know them. Your right and left bracket, so the ones to the right of the P key on your keyboard, the square brackets, you can use those to actually increase and decrease your grid snap value. So if you use the left one, it decreases it, and you use the right one, it increases it. So it's handy to know. And then we're going to bring our lock forward so it's not actually behind the door. Oh, and so here's a problem. Because we just created a collision box around the door, because Epic actually didn't make it fit to the door itself, it's going to be based on the knob. And so if we put our lock hanging off of this doorknob, like I was about to, you're going to see that you can't actually interact with it. And that's because it's underneath the collision for the door. So we're actually going to have it floating in front of the lock, sorry, the doorknob there. We're going to see that's actually really low on the ground anyways. So you know what? Excuse me. Let's forget about this visual aesthetic, and we'll just put our lock right there. And when we hit play, we should see. Okay, so now checking our controls. When we left click right now, we should get shooting like we did before. And when we right click, we get nothing. Now inside the trigger, when we left click, we're going to get a line trace, which is exactly what we want. And when we right click, we're going to get a line trace. And that only happens when we're inside the trigger. Right clicking is doing nothing right now. So that's perfect. That's exactly what we want. And we should be able to see, well, for starters, our tumblers are actually randomized. So that's great. 2, 5, 5, 3. And now when we left click, we should see that the tumbler spins forward, and we right click, it spins backwards, which is exactly what we want. So we can get rid of that giant square by going back into our first person character and turning this off. The square is the impact point. And now we can see we'll be able to successfully rotate our combo. And I think we can test it out if I haven't forgotten anything. So we want 0, 1, 2, and oh, we should go backwards. 4, 3. Ba-doom. And then our door opens. Even though it opens backwards, it's fine. So, one last thing we want to do, and I actually discovered this. So firstly, I'm going to select the door. I'm going to take the rotation amount. I'm going to put it to a negative. And that should actually fix the way the direction it opens. I'm going to trust that it does because I know it will. So one other thing I actually realized is that inside of our lock, sorry, inside of our tumbler actually, we have set up this do once to stop the player from being able to spam the mouse press, which is fantastic. However, we don't have any way of preventing the player from spamming by left clicking, then right clicking, then left clicking, then right clicking, because we're resetting this after it finishes, but it's not going to stop you from left click, right click. It will stop you from doing it again, but you can do a little bit of spamming by doing a left right and spin the tumbler forward and then backwards. So if we take a look at that, we're gonna go left, 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 right, and you see then we get a weird skip. Left, 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 right, left, right, left, right, left, right. As you spam it, it really screws the animations up. So to add in an extra spam filter there. What we're going to do is we're going to create, oh, and I already did it actually. You guys might have noticed this earlier. We're creating a variable, another Boolean, and we're calling it tumbler moving. So I can get rid of that tag filter there. So that's what you guys want to do. I'll just delete that and we'll add it in again. So add a new variable, call it tumbler moving question mark. And let's see, we want to, let me wake my brain up and think about this for a second here, guys. Okay, so we want to back these out a little bit more, both of them. And we're going to set our tumbler moving by alt dragging that in. I'm going to set our tumbler moving to true here. And we're also going to set our tumbler moving to true here. So essentially, once we've clicked, once we've pressed our key, we're going to assume the tumbler is moving. Now, technically, the tumbler isn't moving until this update plays. However, because it's instantaneous, we're actually going to just set it ahead of time because it makes it easier. This code, what I meant by it's instantaneous is this code runs and then a frame later this code is going to run, so it might as well be true at that point. Then what we're going to do is we're going to branch in front here. So we're going to move those forward and we're going to pull this back out. And we're going to get our tumbler moving and branch and plug that in here. And if tumbler moving is false, then we will actually allow the spin tumbler to happen. And same thing here. We're going to branch. And if tumbler moving is false, oops, spin tumbler, put that up there. Tumbler moving, drag that in. So if tumbler moving is false, will allow us to go again. And then what we're going to do is down here, after we finish, so we're going to do the number check. We can pretty much put it in anywhere here. So I'm going to just put it in before the number check here. We're going to set our tumbler moving to false again. Drag these ones over, alt drag in, and set our tumbler moving to false, and then reset tumbler reset. Trying to think if there's any disadvantage to doing it there. You know what, let's I'm gonna undo these here a little bit, and we're actually gonna do it right after we reset. The reason being is if we're trying to prevent people from spamming, we want to make sure that we're activating these at the exact right moment. And if we set the tumbler moving to false before we reset, I can think that it might actually cause some issues. Probably not, but just to be safe, we're going to do that there. Probably pull that in and then control click to grab that one as well, bring that in. And also you'll notice that I zoomed in there just before I brought it in. That's because sometimes when you zoom out, you'll see that the space increases. These ones shrink just so that everything can fit on the screen. So you want to do your placement while you're actually zoomed in. And this should be good there. So we'll drag that out and we'll drag it this way here and replace it along the line there. Don't need to, but as I've explained multiple times, I'm OCD, so I'm gonna do it anyways. And now when we take a look at our tumbler, you should see, whoops, this thing is rather small and our movement speed is fast. You should see that this anti-spamming has now worked, because you're noticing I'm left clicking, right clicking, but it's not skipping like it was earlier. So that's perfect. So again, we can go to 0, 1, 2, and 3. Then within a second, it unlocks, falls to the floor. Oh, interesting. It changed its lock state while it was falling. Wonder why that's happening. Play. I'm going to just take a look at that. We're going to go back to 0, 1, 2. Oh, look at that. It was almost set. So it falls to the ground. Interesting. I wonder why it falls to the ground in a locked state. I didn't notice that before. Anyways, guys, this is essentially working, but let's take a look here. If you guys want to stop, you're welcome to, but I'm going to just take a look and see if I can figure out why the lock state would be changing, because it's not changing here. We've got our lock state set to during this. We are setting our lock state to open. Then we're simulating physics, and we have never set our lock state back to closed. That's very strange. You shouldn't be flipping our lock state there. It's never changing here either. It might just be that because it it might be something to do with, you know what, let's set our default lock state to true there as well. I don't know that that's going to make a difference, actually, because it might be something to do with the fact that when it simulates physics, 0, 1, 2, it, whoops, it might be that when it simulates physics, it has to go back to its default state. But you know what? I think that's, we're being nitpicky at that point. Something that most people wouldn't notice. Anyways, there you have it, guys. I'm not going to bother figuring that out because it's just way too minuscule to matter. If anybody does figure it out, though, feel free to post your solution in the comments down below. But guys, that's the end of our tutorial here. I hope this has helped you guys out in creating a combination lock for your games, and maybe it's also you know, improved your understanding of blueprints. If you like this video, then please be sure to hit that like button below. And also, if you haven't already done so, please subscribe to the channel, because it's what's going to motivate me to continue creating new content. As always, guys, it's been great, and I'll see you again next time. Thanks a lot. Bye.